I want to start with one sermon dissolution of a partnership form. Look at the sermon on the screen. Smita, Neeta, Geeta are partners sharing profits and losses in the ratio of 1:1:3. The balance sheet was as under on 31st of December 2010. When the firm was dissolved, capital of Smita and Neeta, 25,000 and 3,000. Capital of Geeta, 5,000 debit balance. Fixed assets, investment, stock, debtors as bad debt, is a joint life policy, cash and bank. Cash balance, profit and loss account, debit balance 10,000 and debit balance of Geeta. On liability side also, General Reserve Investment Fluctuation Fund, Dhiraj's Loan Depreciation Fund, creditors bills payable. Particulars regarding dissolution were as under, fixed assets realized 20% less than the depreciated value. 90% of the stock realized 20% whereas remaining 10% of the stock realized 10% more. Joint life policy realized 8,000 where 22,000 could be recovered from debtors. Bills receivable discounted with the bank was dishonored and 15,000 was paid to the bank. No amount was received from the drawee. Dissolution expenses amounted to 7,600. Neeta was declared insolvent. See, Neeta is having a credit balance of capital account. Even then she is insolvent. While Geeta has a debit balance, she is not insolvent, she is solvent. Neeta was declared insolvent, brought only 400 from her property, passed necessary, prepared necessary accounts that according to Garner versus Moore's decision, also passed the journal entry for distribution of capital deficiency. Now see, this is a sum which we are required to solve as per decision of Garner versus Moore. Application of this decision requires one of the partners should be insolvent, one, and that insolvent partner is unable to pay the dues towards the firm or debit balance of such partner is not recoverable. That not recoverable amount is known as capital deficiency. As per Garner versus Moore, this capital deficiency is not a business loss, loss of operating activities of the business. So such loss cannot be distributed among solvent partners in the ratio of profit sharing. Notice that here Neeta is insolvent. Share of Smita and Geeta is 1:3. Neeta's share is 1. So the capital deficiency loss of Neeta cannot be distributed in the ratio of 1:3 between Smita and Geeta because that is an agreed ratio for distributing business profits and losses, and the capital deficiency of a partner is not a business loss. So it cannot be distributed in the profit sharing ratio, but it has to be distributed in the ratio of capital that existed on the date of balance sheet as pronounced by Justice Joyce in the decision of Garner versus Moore. Over and above this, it is recommended, is said in that decision, that the solvent partners are required to bring cash equivalent to their share in the realization loss. That also we are going to take care of. After considering these things, let us start with the sum. Here I am going to prepare necessary accounts. They are realization account, capital accounts and cash account. Copy the balance sheet is my first step. So I am required to copy the balance sheet, means assets to be realized are debited to realization account, liabilities to be settled are credited to realization account. Capital balances are distributed, profits and losses are transferred to the respective capital accounts of the partners. Cash balance will appear in cash account. Let us start. Here, look at this is my balance sheet. All these assets to be realized are transferred to the debit side of realization account. Fixed asset debited to realization account. Investment 20,000 debited to realization account. Stock 30,000 debited to realization account. Debtors 32,000 debited to realization account. Bad debt is of 7,000 credited to realization account. Joint life policy 15,000 debited to realization account. Cash balance, opening balance 5,000. This profit and loss account debit 10,000 is a loss that will be distributed in the ratio of 1:1:3. So 10,000 distributed in the ratio of 1:1:3. So 1/5 of 10,000, 2,000, 1/5 of 10,000, 2,000, and 3/5 of 10,000 amounts to 6,000. So 2,000, 2,000, and 6,000 will be distributed between Smita, Nita, and Gita. Notice it. 2,000, 2,000, and 6,000. This is how profit and loss account debit balance 10,000 is distributed amongst partners. Gita's debit balance 5,000 debited to Gita's capital account 5,000. Now I want to consider the details given on the liability side of the balance sheet. On the liability side, I am given the balance of Smita's capital 25,000, Nita's capital 3,000. This general is of 35,000 distributed in the ratio of 1:1:3. 1 plus 1 plus 3, 5. 35,000 divided by 5, 7 5s are 35, 7,000, 7,000 and 21,000. So this is how general reserve is distributed among partners in the ratio of profit sharing, that is 1:1:3. Notice it. After that, this investment fluctuation fund, reserve against asset, credited to realization account, depreciation fund, Dhiraj's loan, 10,000, depreciation fund, 35,000, creditors 80,000 and bills payable credited to realization account 25,000. This is a copy of the balance sheet is open. All the details of assets and liabilities are recorded in accounting for dissolution. Now this is a sum on Gardner versus Murray. One of the partners is insolvent and the capital deficit has to be distributed in the proportion of capital that existed on the date of dissolution. So let me find out the capital ratio of solvent partners. Find the capital ratio of solvent partners. Nita is declared insolvent, so keep Nita away to find out the capital ratio of solvent partners. Smita and Gita are the solvent partners. Credit total of Smita 25 plus 7, 32 minus 2000, balance 30,000. Let me work out the balance for Gita 21,000. Minus 6 plus 5, 11,000. That amounts to 10,000. Capital ratio is 3:1. In this ratio, the capital deficit of Nita will be distributed among solvent partners. Notice it. After this gets over, let me realize the assets. Assets are realized. Fixed assets realized 20% less of its depreciated value. So, let me work it out. Fixed assets 110,000 minus depreciation for 35,000. This is the depreciated value. 20% less than the depreciated value, so 75,000 into 20%, 15,000. So amount received for fixed asset is 60,000. Cash account debit to realization account credit 60,000. This is how the realized value of fixed assets gets recorded. Now, next. 90% of the stock realized 20%, where the remaining 10% of the stock realized 10% note. Let us prepare the parking for that. Stock 30,000, 90% there of 27,000. 27,000 realized 90% of the value. So 27,000 into 90% amount realized is 24,300. And the remaining stock 10% of 30,000, 3,000. Realized 110%, 10% more than the book value. So 3,300. So total value realized for that is 26,600 cash account debit to realization account credit. This is how, look at the working note. 90% of the stock realized 90%, 10% of the stock realized 110%. Cash to realization. Joint life policy realized 8,000, where 20,000 to be recovered from debtors. for joint life policy, look at it, 15,000. Cash to realization, debtors realized, 22,000 cash to realization. Notice that as and when the assets were realized, I prepared a yellow shade on the asset side. Just to bring to your notice that you are not given the information about what amount realized for investment. Now investment are 20,000 and fluctuation fund is 7,000. So what amount should be considered to have been realized for investment? Investment is a real asset. For real asset, if you are not told in the sum, we presume that book value is realized. So here the book value is 20,000. Let me write down 20,000 as the value realized for investment. So cash account debit 20,000 to realization account credit 20,000. Now if any of you may feel that 20,000 minus 7,000, 13,000 should be taken as the book value and we should realize only 13,000. Of course you can do it by writing a note for that. But I have taken here 20,000. The reason is, for fixed assets you are told that the 20% less than the depreciated value. Here for investment you are not told anything about depreciated value to be taken. So nothing is told to you about investment, what amount realized. So it's a matter of presumption. I have presumed that book value is realized, so 20,000 is realized. Cash account debit 20,000 to realization account credit 20,000. If any of you may write a note that it is presumed that the investment realized, 20,000 minus 7,000, 13,000, you may be right. Okay. Bills receivable discounted with the bank was dishonored. Rupees 15,000 was paid to the bank. No amount was received from the drawing. So, discounted bill dishonored, we are required to pay to the bank on behalf of a customer who has accepted the bill. When we pay on behalf of customer, we can collect the money from the customer for bill being honored at his instance. But here we are told that nothing could be recovered from drawing, so it should be treated as bad debt loss. And we are required to pay for such loss. So the journal entry for that is realization account debit to cash account credit to deficit. Realization account debit to cash account credit, bill receivable discounted, dishonored, and nothing could be recovered from the drawing. Now see. So this is our entry for discounted bill dishonored, nothing recoverable. What's the entry? Realization account debit to cash account. Distribution expenses were paid 7,600. So realization account debit 7,600 to cash account credit 7,600. Now notice how many, what are the liabilities we have paid so far and which are yet to be paid. So at the time of dissolution, we have to pay dissolution expenses and all the liabilities need to be paid. So notice it. Other liabilities have to be paid at a book value, dealer's loan, creditors and bills payable. These are the three liabilities which we have not yet paid. So we should pay at the time of dissolution. And what is the amount to be paid for that? Book value. So dealer's loan account debit to cash account, creditors account debit to cash account, and bills payable account debit to cash account. This is how all liabilities are paid. After that, we should work out the profit or loss on realization of assets and liabilities. Here total of debit side minus total of credit side, we get the realization loss. From 344,600, we are required to deduct all these things. We get a loss of 43,000. These loss will be distributed amongst partner in the ratio of 1:1:3. So 43,000 distributed in the ratio of 1:3. So 1/5 is the share of Smita, 1/5 of the share of Nita, and 3/5 of 43,000 is the share of Gita. So this is a realization loss. Losses are debited to the partner's capital account. So Smita's capital account debit, Nita's capital account debit, Gita's capital account debit to realization account credit, 43,000. As per Garner versus Murray, The realization loss is brought in cash by the solvent partners. So who are the solvent partners? Smita and Gita are the solvent partners. They have to bring cash equal to their share in realization loss. So Smita brings 8,600, Gita brings 25,800. Cash account debit to Smita's capital account credit, cash account debit to Gita's capital account credit. This is how cash brought by the solvent partner equal to the realization loss suffered by them. Record the entry for cash brought by the solvent partner. Nita was declared insolvent and brought only 400 rupees from her property. So cash account debit 400 to Nita's capital account credit 400. Now let me find out the capital deficit of Nita's insolvent partner's capital account. Look at it. Total of debit side, 2000 plus 8600, 10,600. Total of credit side, 10,400. Total of credit side, 3000 plus 7000, 10,600 is a capital deficit. Against that, she brings only 400. So there is a capital deficit of 200. This capital deficit share of Smita is 3/4. 3/4. This is the capital balance and capital ratios on the date of dissolution. So 200 into 3/4, 150 is the share of Smita and Gita. 200 into 150 is the share of Gita. Now this is the capital deficit suffered by Smita and Gita. What's the journal entry for that? Smita's capital account debit 150, Gita's capital account debit 50 to Nita's capital account credit 200. Now let us go for its posting. Smita account debit, Nita account credit, Gita account debit, Nita account credit. This is how Nita's capital account is closed. Now I am required to close the capital account of other partners, solvent partners. 10,600 and 10,600 is closed. 40,600 minus this debit, this is the amount to be paid to Smita, 29,850. So Smita's capital account debit 29,850 to cash account credit 29,850. And for Gita, 46,800 minus 5,000, 6,000, 25,850. 9950 is the amount payable to Gita. So Gita's capital account debit 9950 to cash account credit 9950. So partner's capital is ready. Now your cash account should tell it. Total of debit and total of credit should be same. Look at it. The total of debit and credit will be 1,77,400. This is how your cash account will tell it. And this is how sum gets solved as per Gardner vs. Moore. Thanks to all of you.